Welcome back to another episode of Sinjin.io. The weather is now sun showers. Pretty sweet. Let's keep going reading email. Where did we leave off? Sinjin Day, say cheese. Okay, remember when I said I only had one thing to complain about Westerners living here? Well, I have another one, so sorry, but here I go. I'm complaining about cheese. That's right. Talking nonstop about your precious, precious cheeses and how they don't exist here. Definitely not in the quality, quantity, quality, and variety that they do in France or Wisconsin or wherever. Well, it might be hard to wrap your head around the fact that an entire civilization and one of the top culinary traditions in the world has developed entirely without curdled milk solids, but it's true. It happened. Which is not to say I don't like cheese myself. I do. Late at night, you might even find me at the McDonald's on Shannon Road eating cheeseburgers like the gluttonous young modern global citizen that I am. I'm just saying there are plenty of good and legitimate food that exists without cheese, and it's not like you're going to die for the lack of it. Anyway, when you take a picture, don't say cheese in China, because why would you say that? You say eggplant. You heard me. Say it right, and it sounds kind of like cheese. Maybe. Yours, Tilly. Learn all kinds of things. Pocket Eye Chan Oracle. Have you noticed I Ching, sometimes in the West known as the Book of Changes, experiencing a resurgent in popularity lately? For the benefit of those out of the loop, let me explain briefly. Let me briefly explain. A hexagram is a set of six lines where each line is either solid or broken, with a total of 64 possible combinations. There is obviously much more to it, but I don't want to go into it too deeply. I've been studying the system for a while, but I wish there was a quicker way to generate hexagrams. I thought perhaps this ancient divination method might be brought into the modern era somehow as a pocket device. Six coin flips, is it then? Not at all. There's much more detailed process through which one arrives at reading involving yellow stalks. I stopped by to try to describe it to you, but you weren't at your desk. Suffice it to say that we will need to generate the readings in the proper way if it is to be taken seriously as a divination tool. I found a part that works for this. It implements the physical Yarrow stick method in miniature. MIMS. Strange. So we can just create the display for the result. Obviously, interpretation is up to the user. Okay. Button and Oracle are simple inputs connected to MIMS-based Oracle engine. Button and Oracle. Two inputs. Display 0 through 5 are simple outputs connected to a display segment on a custom LCD for I-Ching hexagrams from bottom display 0 to top display 5. When the button is pushed, the Oracle will generate six values corresponding to the segments display 0 through display 5. When the final number is generated, the display should be updated to match the six numbers. Okay, it says when the button is pushed, the Oracle engine would generate six values corresponding to display segments 0 through 5. So these two are inputs. I'll have to hook up a device to monitor what the hell's going on with this thing, because it's fairly odd. Trying to monitor this stuff move before I start building anything. These should be inputs, right? Like, I don't really understand where the... Let's see. Oops. Shorts. Zero. 100. Yeah, so it's generating this data just like it shows. So there's the hundreds. And there's the 100 on the Oracle input. So this is the Oracle input. But I don't understand what this thing is doing. Is this anything? Is this nothing? Doesn't look like this is doing anything. It's not anything. Never any value. It's always zero. So I guess this side's nothing. So forget that side. Alright, so what is going on here? How do these button inputs map to anything? Oracle inputs. Let's just move 100 into both of these. Let's see what happens. Bottom thing. Okay, so it's like goofy lines. It's like dots right here. Okay, so that's display zero. This is display zero right here. So when this is done, display zero is on. Display one, display three, and display five. So two and four off for some extremely mysterious reason. Thank you. When the final number is generated, the display should be updated to match the six numbers. Generate six values corresponding to the segments. Display 0 through display 5. This is the final number right here, and then it got... Zero, two, three, four on. That really doesn't make any sense to me yet. Because I don't see how you translate this into... display numbers, because there's like six display values. And why is this one switching right here? It's really not clear why these values all switch right here when this input is going high. And they all switch right here when this input goes low. And they switch right here when this input is neither high nor low, but was it steady state? Like, why does it switch right here? That's super mysterious. Same thing for this one. Like, what causes them to switch right here? On for six, and then it's on for like seven. I'm just looking to see if I can find a pattern and see a pattern in these. Like, there's obviously the size of these things. So this could be like meaning, okay, what's three? You know, it's like a one, three, two, and then two, one, and then four. But the super mysterious thing is it's switching before it even gets to four. So it's like a one and a three. Because this switch, this is a one and a three, and it switched to zero, and here it's one. See, this line, this display 5 went to 0. And over here, it's staying at 100. And it's unclear why it's staying at 100 when everything else switched. Maybe it knows it's a 4, because it right there kind of knows it's a 4. And here there was like no change, unless it's later. Yeah, it's almost like you need to say, well, if it's this pattern, then output this. If it's this pattern, output this. If this pattern, output this. If it's this pattern, output this. And this pattern, output this. And each pattern is 1, 2, 3, 4, 5. 1, 2, 3, 4, 5. 1, 2, 3, 4, 4. Weird. When the button is pushed, which makes 6 values. It's weird because when the button's pushed, it doesn't change. Like it almost like it triggers. It's weird how like when the button's pushed, all of them go high. This input always goes high, except for this one. Why didn't it go high here? Is it basically 1 1 0 1 0? Is that what I'm reading? 1 1 0 1 0 1. I think that might be it. So 1 0 1. 1 1 0. So it just reads the state of this thing for 5 times. It basically stores it in the memory unit and then displays it. Starting with immediately when the button goes high. Let's see if we can just make sure that that's what's happening. I think it is though, so we need to route this to a pin. Figure out the optimal placement for these stupid parts. Because I think I'm gonna need to be able to read. I need to be able to read both sides of this thing. Thank you. Something like that. And then I'll need to read. I'm gonna totally run out of room still. Because in order to set this stuff, I need a bunch of pens. I could use two of these dudes. I wonder if I could actually get away with just like this. It might actually work. If I could fit it all in this amount of instruction space though. Which might be possible. Probably the way that they figured you'd program it. It's probably possible. All right, looks ready. All right, let's see. We want to read the button input when it goes high. So the button input is P1. Test if P1 is equal to 100. Instructions already. That one line is way too much. But let's ignore that for now. And then once that's ready, then we'll move P0 into X. X0. Move 5 into ACC. Read sub 1, test if ACC is 0, if it isn't, then jump to read. Let's test our little contraption here. Okay, it's 0. I need to sleep in there. So I have 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6 values, I think, put in there. 1, 2, 3, 4, 5. I need to have 6. So now I have 5 instructions or whatever left to actually dump it out to change the pins immediately based on all the reading. And I need to change X2 and X3. So let's see, if I move 1, is it 1, 1, 1 into X3? Move let's see, 010 into X2. Let's just test this. Breakpoint right there. Why did that change? Jump to read. To 1-1, so that's all on. Okay, so we need to basically let's open up our manual. And then check out these instructions that I can use. So I wonder if I don't really have to store it. Kind of curious about that. Because I probably could do multiplication, I have to store something. Because if I read it and then add it and then multiply by 10, the previous result, and just keep adding. I really only have a couple spots. I have like three. Three instructions left to actually go read all this crap and loop. Another instruction. So 4. 1, 2, 3, 4. And this one has to be jump, read. Conditionally. And this is. Instruction. Not even really, because it's kind of. Kind of tricky to do that there. Maybe I don't want to loop. I could try without looping. So let's say move 0 into A0. Not A0, X1. And then let's read. Move. So to read it, I'm going to move X0 into ACC. What if I can get rid of the loop here too? Like move. Just like unroll the loops because I only need to do it 6 times. That's probably gonna be worse. I could try it. So I'm gonna read P0 into back. This would be 100. Test of dat is 100 is move mul back 10 mul by 10 add 1 always mul by 10. So you need to do this a bunch of times. Test if P0. You can test a pin a bunch of times, so you can have to move it. Move 0 into ACK. So I bet you could do something like this. It's probably best to loop it because otherwise it's going to be big. So yep. Let's see. I think we might be able to do it differently. Even if those look pretty, I don't think you need all this stuff. I think what we can do, hopefully, is switch all this to be, let's see, test if P0 is 100, jump sleep, and then sleep is sleep for 1. And then move 0 into ACK. Let's see, loop 3 is mul by 10. Test if P0 is 100, add 1. I wonder if it's really weird. I wonder if you do have to do a bigger one. Because I don't know how you keep track of how many times you've... So if you don't... So this will add up all three. I think if we step through this... This should add up. Yeah, this is 110. Wait. It's not sleeping. So it needs to also sleep in here. It's a bunch of stuff you need to do. Things you're using axe, so you'd have to switch between ack and dat to even like loop this thing. Unless you tested it was greater than. Greater than 100. No, it couldn't be that because the first one could be 0. Let's try using like a math coprocessor kind of idea. Or we just say move P0 into X1 like 3 times and then let's sleep in between. Don't want to do that. You actually want to move test if it's equal to. Well, either could do the test, I suppose. But I think it's better to have this one. So let's say we can move 3 into ack, and then we could do a loop, and then move it not into X1, but move into don't even need to move it. Test if P0 is 100. If it is, then we'll move 0 into X1. Otherwise, or 1 into X1. Otherwise, we'll move 0 into X1. And then we'll subtract 1, and then Test of equal to. Test of ack is equal to 0. And if it's not, jump to loop. It's a lot of work just to loop this thing. Okay, well, I got the 110. Okay, and then it got to here. Trying to figure out how to get it out of this thing because it's at a pin. You know, you always set it to equal to a pin, but I got no pin states to like read it from. And I could set it equal to, I could push it into an X bus, but it's gonna get locked unless somebody's reading it. It. And maybe that has the inputs right here. Maybe like one of these. And it, you know, writes, you know, to that guy, and then this guy feeds into it. That might work. Switch these around. Like that might work. So this is always writing to, let's move this one over so I can see the variable name. Let's always move it, move ack into x1 just every frame, and then we'll Let's see. Sleep until X1. But you see, I'll need to accumulate two of them. I don't know if I can really do that. So why is that wrong? So it was 110. 110. But you see it was read in the wrong order. So I'm waiting to the third one and then I'm writing it. I'm ignoring the top piece for now, but this piece is wrong. That's a pretty tough layout. I don't know. I'm trying to figure out how to get to the A0. I think I need to be able to set the A0 to the, set the address register correctly. And then once it's all set, then I have to... trigger this one. That kind of actually works. It's weird. So I could use a DST instruction, maybe. If I didn't move, I said test if P0 is 100. If it is, then move 1. Let's move 0. Into X2. That's right. It's off by one because of the sleep, but I'm sleeping right now. I don't want to sleep because I need to wait for it to actually happen. This is a really bad idea. Well, I got this correct anyway. Do I even write to X1? I do test if X1's there, yeah. You have to reset it. Yeah, I wish I could tell this one. I wish I had another X, an X bus right here. I don't see how I get another X bus because I'm using these two and I'm using these two. I have a pin. Which is a pretty dumb way to do it, but maybe I could do it that way. When does P1 get written to? It's 0 right now. Oh, this is not an extra pin. Because it's connected right there. I wonder if I could test, like, test X0. Test it against, like, some Sentinel, like, 50. Or something strange. And then instead of moving, let's move 50 into X1. See, every time I test it, it's moving it. Isn't it? Yep. It auto advances. I think I need to connect this X bus to the other one and not A1. I don't know if I can do that very easily. maybe something like this, where this one talked to this one, needs some packets and it writes to there. But then how does this get reset? See, I prefer to hook up both of these. See if it is, then let's try to combine. I think we're just running out of space. I think that's the issue. Test ACC with 0, no 1. Test ACC with 0. So you can't use ACC because it's going to rewrite it. Constantly changing that. You have to loop it twice too, it's really tough. Because if you start making this the accumulator, then what do you do when you're done with it? How about like that? I still need to connect this one. Thank you. about like that? Where this one tells this one when to go, and this one reads, and then fires it off. And the cross talks back. That might work. I don't know if I really like this design. I'm gonna try another design. Let's just put a big one in for fun, just for now. Let's see. Instead of trying to compute the value right here, we're just going to move it into, going to move x3, move 0 or 1 into x3. And then we're going to do that. I don't know how many times, let's say 3 times. I don't know if you can double this though. If it's equal to 3, then let's move x1 into dat. guy will sleep until X3. And then DST X3 into ACC. DS3-0 into ACC. And then move PCC into X3. I have to put a sleep one into each of these. Something like that. So we moved one into X. Move into X1, actually. So now we've told it. Okay, we have a 1 over here. Okay, it's waiting. There's our 110, which is 110, which is correct. Now we're going to do the same thing for the next 3, which is 101, which is good. Move DAT into X3. If I can just save a few more instructions, I might be able to do it. And then get rid of the initialize for now. Otherwise, if it is, then move back into X2, X3, and move dat into X2. Something like this might work. Okay, we're gonna move that into, wait, not ACK into X3. We're gonna move X1 into X3. Goes. Part not sleeping. Why is it not sleeping? It's very close. I can feel it. A few more tweaks. is jumping a loop because there's a minus there because this test is invalidating it. Test if it's equal to zero. If it is, then jump to sleep. Holy cow. No. Oh no, it didn't work. I'm a failure. Back is 5. Isn't it? Test of P0. Test of P1. Test of P1 is 0. P1 is the button. There we go. Ah! Take that, crazy game. Beat you. All right, that was an annoyingly difficult challenge. Somebody did it pretty cheap, as expected. That's not too many people did that. I think that's like, what, a $3 part and a $2 part, maybe? No. That's like $7. So yeah, maybe a 5 and a 2. That's pretty interesting. All right, let's return to Mimo. Splendid, how wonderful that such a device was created right here in China, where it all began. I'll probably even use this oracle myself as Xiaomei and I approach our wedding day. David is more Chinese than even a Chinese person. Thanks. All right. See you next time on Shenzhen IO.